Stringer and the Oil Well Indians, number 10, by Lou Cameron, narrated by Barry Press. Chapter 1. The first thing Stringer noticed about Tulsa was that he seemed overdressed for the occasion. Recalling the erstwhile flag stop of Creek City as a cow town, he dropped off the night train in faded but clean blue denims and a reasonably clean Rough Rider hat that was supposed to be pearl gray. But the planks of the railroad platform were coated with sticky black rock oil, and a mist of the same stinky stuff was descending on him from the sullen red midnight sky. So he ran with his Gladstone bag for the shelter of the depot waiting room, lest he wind up looking like that tar baby in the Uncle Remus stories. As he braced his already greasy Gladstone on a bench to get his yellow rain slicker, an older gent puffing a pipe across the aisle chuckled and said, "Great minds run in the same channels. Old Black Jack Sinclair just brung in another gusher up to the west end of town. Won't be a fit night out for man or beast till they cap the son of a bitch with a Christmas tree." He spat and added morosely, "I wish they wouldn't drill right here in town, don't you?" Stringer didn't answer until he'd slipped into his slicker. Then he opined rock oil sure smelled disgusting. As the old-timer allowed there was money in stink, if you had enough of it to sell, Stringer considered the S&W 38, reposing in its coiled gun rig atop his other possibles. The Indian nation had been rough country in its day, he knew. But hell, a new century had dawned, and they were calling it the Oklahoma Territory these days. He'd been sent to do a feature on the spanking new rock oil industry, not to start a war. So he proceeded to shut the lid on his old six-gun, and would have, had not the street-side door crashed open to admit a burly black figure with a .48 in each hand and a string of curses already blasting from his lips. Since Stringer heard his own name braided in with, "Nosy son of a bitch!" and "Meddling motherfucker!" he naturally dove to the floor and rolled under the bench with the gun from his own open bag, just as the greasy gunslick in the doorway got down to tearing slivers from the backrest of the bench with a fusillade of flying slugs. Blinded by his own gun smoke in the poorly lit waiting room, the cuss in the doorway ceased fire long enough to call out, "Where are you at? Stand up and fight like a man, you pencil-pushing sissy boy!" So Stringer rose, where he wasn't expected to, and put three rounds into his attacker's chest with somewhat better aim. The black hulk staggered back outside, and the sprung door swung shut as if nothing much had happened. A still-smoking .45 that lay just inside the door told Stringer something had. He knew better than to chase the other gun, and whoever might still be holding it out that way. So he whirled and ran out the doorway on the platform side as, behind him, an elderly voice called wistfully, "Hey, can I come out now?" Stringer didn't know. So he just circled the frame building until he could stick his head and gun muzzle around a street-side corner to see what he might have wrought. There were no street lamps shining at this hour, but the glowering light of the red sky above illuminated the black form near the doorway well enough for Stringer to move closer, reloading as he watched for any signs of life, and failing to see any. There were no signs of life from the man he'd just shot. But there were plenty of other black figures headed his way now, drawn to the sounds of gunplay. Stringer kicked the remaining six gun near the dead man inside as he opened the door and followed it, calling out, "It's over, old son. I sure hope you'll recall whose notion it was to start it." The old-timer he'd been talking to before didn't answer. He wasn't there anymore. Some gents were like that when two gents they neither knowed nor owed got into a fight that could lead to all sorts of tedious questions. So Stringer was standing alone by his open Gladstone, his .38 holstered under his slicker, while he rolled a smoke and waited for the inevitable. The inevitable entered with his own gun drawn and a silver star pinned to his oily slicker. Stringer noticed the deputy had a slight but hard-to-place accent as he nodded in a friendly enough way and announced, "I'd be Deputy Marshal Chris Madsen. I hope you've heard of me. I don't like to brag, but it can save unfortunate moves on the parts of others if I just say my name."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.